ask a question or two, let me add one small point, which almost, in fact, as I recall from my reading, at least you can correct me, there are some scholars here who may know better, no one seems to have noticed, and that is that at the very, very beginning of Zarathustra, you have a vignette, and I cut this for the sake of time from the text, you have a vignette where an adder, which is an interesting thing, a snake, right, this is the beginning, comes up to Zarathustra and bites him in the bosom, right? You know, when you're going to have a quote from a classical text, you might as well pile one on the other, and he bites him. And Zarathustra says, yeah, why'd you do that? You know, he says, well, it doesn't matter, I'll go on. And the adder says, you won't be going on very far. My venom is poisonous. Ah, well, take it back then. And the adder, we read, and all Nietzscheans believe this, falls on his neck a second time, takes it back. To me, if I read Nietzsche's Zarathustra the way I would read Stephen King or any other text, I know that what follows is a dream before dying. It is not the case that Zarathustra's adder bites him back and reverses the laws of nature in that way, because we're talking about teaching the will to will, to will backwards and say, thus I will it. So it's rather overdetermined, in addition to the small matters of the poisonousness of venom. So that means that we have a story that is a story about death all the way down. Not going to die, dying. Thank you.
I was wondering if you could say a few words about where you put book four within the plot of Zarathustra. So when he does this honey sacrifice at the beginning, where does that honey come from?
Well, that's a very, very good question. Where does the honey come from? I've already suggested that the honey itself is an invocation, an invocation of a particular way of living and one that avoids the kinds of crimes that you're already bringing on yourself. In the Orphic tradition, and in the Greek tradition in general, there's a problem with sustaining yourself in the way we ordinarily sustain ourselves. One of the things what scholars and classes find annoying and, you know, why can't we eat beans? You know, and we worry so much about not being able to eat beans because our big concern is flesh. The minute someone explains what really follows from the Orphic doctrine, from Empedocles, from Anaximander, one immediately hunts about for, oh, bloodshed, bad. How about oysters? They have no blood. Of course there's blood, we just can't see it. Grasshoppers have blood, it's just a different color. So you have a reference there to a particular kind of teaching which concerns certain approaches to death and rebirth. If you're teaching the eternal recurrence, you are Empedoclean whether you want to be or not. And Nietzsche is conscious of this. I mean, you would be anyway, whether you'd read it or not, because you're taking on a trope that is available to you in all manner of ways in other texts you've read. But Nietzsche studies this. This is what he works on. So when he invokes eternal recurrence, he is not simply coming up with a wonderful thing, which Poincaré is also demonstrating at the same time as a consequence of a closed universe on thermodynamic terms, because if there's no energy in and no energy out, then you've got permutation, and Poincaré is a great mathematician, so he says, here's how it works. There's a beautiful theory, not only of relativity that's parallel to Einstein, but also of the eternal recurrence. Just like Nietzsche's cocktail, you know, napkin jottings, which he doesn't publish. And Poincaré's proofs work. That's the important thing to know. They are proofs that work. Nietzsche, what do you want from him? To also be a physicist in his spare time or a mathematician, he's not. But he has read this and he's invoking that. But he knows and he is exactly on point when it comes to Empedocles. So his honey sacrifice is an allusion to that. And if I'm right, that we are talking about the Empedocles of the Catharmoi, we have a very interesting phenomenon. If you bring in, because Empedocles appears in Lucian. Empedocles and Swift has Empedocles and Lucian in his dialogue, so people are always throwing him in where you don't know who he is and why he's there. But if he is there, in this particular case in Lucian, he's there doing certain things with regard to the part we didn't get to, because the PowerPoint didn't work, which has to do with the volcano. We all know Empedocles jumps into the volcano. The other portion of the text which I left out is the part which involves an author Everyone in this room who's a respectable academic knows not to read. Call you. I don't think I've ever seen any serious expert on Nietzsche's Zarathustra quote a map. I mean, we're dutiful servants of Freud. Right? Jung was wrong, Freud is right, and quote Freud, which is a strange thing because it's just as bogus if you talk about the science, as Jung. But Jung himself has a huge seminar on Zarathustra. And in that seminar, he does something which is very strange. He talks about something most scholars don't talk about, and that is Zarathustra flying through the air, over the heads of people. You know, the captain puts the shit, they're out there shooting rabbits, etc. Zarathustra goes to the air and says, oh, look, Zarathustra, there he goes, boom, into the volcano. Now, if you fly into a volcano, there are several things that can be said about you. You have magic powers, you have one of those Harry Potter brooms, or you're dead. Right? You're dead. Because it's a standard feature of ghost stories, Gruselgeschichten, in Nietzsche's time, standard feature, that you suddenly know, right, that so-and-so has died because you see him where he should not be. You say, ah, but then at that time my friends told me he had died in London. And that's exactly the account. We have an account which Nietzsche himself, and this is Jung, Jung is simply saying, did Nietzsche steal? No, says Jung. Nietzsche simply read the same book in his grandfather's study that I read in my grandfather's study. And he trots off, because he tells this in this part of his dissertation. So again, roughly about the time that Nietzsche has died. Nietzsche too, like Zarathustra, takes a while to die. Elizabeth first to Nietzsche. Did you not have a copy of Justinus Kerner's book? And Justinus Kerner is someone no one has ever heard of, a Swabian doctor who's only important to me and to many people, not for the stories he wrote, although for Jung that was very important. That's like reading, you know, Reader's Digest at your parents' or grandparents' house because they have nothing else. And Justinus Kerner was there, all of these stories. Blätter was Prevost, and those Blätter, these pages from Prevost, refer to the visions of a seeress of Prevost, who's one of those fashionably comatose young ladies who saw things before dying. She didn't live long, but Kerner wrote down because he was a medical doctor, and it was interesting. He needed to sell the stuff, everything she wrote. When that happened, when he published that, This became something that was widely reproduced. Everyone seemed to have one, and therefore Jung had read the same text, and he recognizes it when he reads. And if you want to, you can go read. He compares the texts. Kerner, Nietzsche, total correspondence, even better than some of the other things Nietzsche's plagiarized from. Nietzsche plagiarizes, of course, massively and constantly. But in this case, Kerner's, the point that Jung has to say is he doesn't have to compare text for text. He read this and remembered it. And it's therefore an unconscious working of an assimilation, and that for him is a proof of the unconscious. For Jung, that proves the unconscious. The fact that he didn't plagiarize proves that there's another agency in us that works in spite of us.
Zarathustra is dying from the beginning. Is there a point in the text where he dies? And the second question is, assuming that he's dying throughout the text, does that call on us to rethink some of the teachings in the text?
I think with the embedded, it's a great, great question. I mean, just let me look at the second one, Larry. That, and I know you know a great deal about this. So the second question for me, we want to rethink them, but as you also know a great deal about embedded plays. We want to rethink them, but if the parallel with Empedocles plays is correct, it is all about things that one should be thinking about when alive. We are all concerned with things that are, at the end of the day, from a philosophical point of view, completely irrelevant, meaningless. And therefore, the kind of things that we usually hunger after are the kinds of things which at the end of the day, middle of the day, and beginning, don't matter. And that's, of course, something which we all say, and none of us, like Lucian's fish, act on.
So with impending death, it sharpens the eye.
It's not that with impending death it sharpens the eye. It's Zarathustra, the only reason. Why would Zarathustra, I mean, everyone looks at this, the goodness of his heart, Zarathustra appears and speaks to the folks in the marketplace. And the folk in this marketplace consider the situation. There Zarathustra says, hello, I teach you the overman. They're not there to see Zarathustra. They're there to see the tightrope walker. That's what they assemble for. It's not, oh, Zarathustra's coming, great guy, let's go hear him. They're there for the spectacle. And the spectacle is the spectacle, literally, couldn't be more overt, of an overman who couldn't be more overt, fall to his death. Over, under. Now, everything Nietzsche tells us is we need to learn to read more literally and simply than we do. But we don't. We come in and say, well, that actually means Socrates at the beginning going down to the Piraeus. Not necessarily. So there's a whole tradition, and of course what that also says to us is when Plato writes, that is the same account. That down going is also a going down to death.
Yes.
That Socrates is talking about, I went down, that is the beginning, and it takes us back. But we stop at that because that's sufficient for us. Plato, Nietzsche too must be stopping with Plato. He's not. He's going back, as Plato himself goes back to another tradition, that is the tradition of the Greek underworld. They have a wretched underworld. I mean, when the overman is stripped, he doesn't simply lose his good smells in his kitchen and his purple dyed cloak. He loses his skin, his flesh. All you have are bones at best. All you've got is a shade. And so there are a whole other associations with the wanderer and his shadow and all those other questions. So so that's the second part. The first part, though, when does he die?
Yeah.
You know, our films are great on that, aren't they? You have those films, we're good at watching those. Someone is dying, you have it, and then suddenly... If the conceit, and it's a conceit, because Nietzsche's not dead, and Zarathustra is a character, and the whole way anything we write is, by definition, a text. So it's, you know, believing is always something you're supposed to be willing to do, but it's something you never need to do. Therefore, that conceit can simply end wherever you please. It stops. It doesn't have to have a moment when he stops, because what you don't have, if this is true, and the question of the position of the narrator is the problem, what you don't have is something as in, that's why many writers are not fond of Rowling, the author of Harry Potter. She gives you the child's idea of a narrator. You're above the overman, you're watching this all as it happens, and you're not in the case of Zarathustra's constant self-reflection. If this is at all a conscious narrative, and most readings that I've read say that it is, then Zarathustra, who's involved in some of the discussions, we both read about Zarathustra, and we see things from Zarathustra's perspective. We read into and out of it, so moving between consciousness and outside of consciousness. I would say the text that Zarathustra is dead at the end of book three. Book four, to go back to that first question, then comes in as a parody. We have it because we have published it, just as the strange confession we philosophers love. Kant's Critique of Pure Reason. What the hell was that? Oh, good. He has an A and a B edition. Let's publish that together. And so we do.
But I still don't see how you claim that he's dying in the text and dies maybe at the third. It's just a really important fact that we need to know about the text, and that it doesn't resonate any further than that with what is in the text.
Oh, the dream of the I mean, actually, there are a number of other loci where it does, of course. But the question then has to do with adding that reference to. I mean, after all, everyone in Mushin's dialogues is dead. Not a problem. Being dead is actually not difficult for written characters. They're good at that. Speaking of
yeah.
Yes, of course.
Who is dying in Zarathustra? Zarathustra or Nietzsche?
Zarathustra.
Both of them?
Empedocles. Zarathustra. So it's a different kind of question. I mean, the other point about that is if it's Empedocles, Zarathustra, Empedocles' beginning topos, which we should all know and none of us do, which is, again, one of the problems, is to say, I quoted it just now, I walk among you, a mortal no more. So the reason Zarathustra comes to talk or descends is to say, although I'm dying, I will be reborn, will return, everything recurs eternally. So it's kind of a moot point for Nietzsche to ask in another sense. But it also means I'm saying this to you so that if the Empedoclean point is right, you can stop the things you do unwittingly that lock you into thrice 10,000. That's a long time to stay in a cycle of things. And it's not a pleasant reincarnation. You don't come back as somebody good. You come back as the gnat you just stepped on. You know, if you read Empedocles, you have this spiny, horrific existence followed with, you know, revulsion and revulsion. You're abhorred by every condition. And why are you abhorred by every condition? Because it's the age of strife. Everything hates everything. And you in this life are hated, and you in the next life too. So it's not so good. So if you have an ear to hear, which is what Nietzsche constantly says, then you might live differently.
We have time for probably one more answer.
One more answer.
Should I take the answer?
Yeah.
Can you make
a distinction between mythoi and logoi? Do you read them differently, or is everything to be taken literally?
I have a problem making that distinction because that locks me into, and I like saying this in Canada, the influence of the Toronto classicists, and I won't do that. So that's something I'm not going to watch. We like to say that they were mythic, the movement is from myth to logos. I'm not sure that's legitimate, so I don't make that distinction. I know you don't mean it that way, Horst. Tracy?
Thank you, Babette. One of the parallels you draw here is between the katharmoi, the purification that you find in Empedocles, and the narrative of Zarathustra. Is it possible to say something about what, is it reasonable to try to say something about what Zarathustra needs to be purified of?
The whole point of the purifications is an expiation for encouragement. And one of the things that we're used to, which proves how very much we are Christians, is that we think that what we need to expiate, if anything, are our sins. And it doesn't occur to us that we sin by our being, that we sin by what we've done to other beings that we simply don't consider. We do not consider it a problem that we devour other beings, that we displace other beings, that we eat other beings. This really doesn't bother us. It's just not an issue. It doesn't occur to us that we are, as Empedocles would say, really brother to or related, or as Nietzsche says in his commentary, that we're consuming ourselves in our disregard of what's around us. So the purification is a purification of, it's not just a matter of obeying God's law.
No.
It's really a matter of recognizing a oneness of things. When we read Empedocles, and I just gave the list of those pre-Socratic thinkers, we are talking about monists, for the most part. We're talking about a doctrine where everything is one. That's true for Parmenides, true for Pythagoras, true for Empedocles, true for Anaximander. We're not used to thinking of that, but that's because we are, all of us, Aristotelians. So we approach the pre-Socratics pretty much sure that they were pretty much wrong about most of what they said, and Aristotle lied. Thank you for the question, and thank you all for your patience.
Sorry about that.